G'day legends, it's Mark here from North Oz, and in today's video we're going to be covering 10 more things that I wish I knew about the 70 series Land Cruiser before buying one. Let's get stuck into it, it's going to be a good one. So for those of you who are new to the channel, I have purchased about 5 months ago now, so enough time to live with it and kind of get to know the ins and outs of the 70 series. I bought this 79 series Land Cruiser. It's a dual cab Workmate, which is exactly what I wanted. So you can see, you can tell that by the little pizza cutter wheels on there. But yeah, I'm really enjoying owning this vehicle, and there's a lot to share about this, and there's a lot of misconceptions. There's also, you know, a lot of things that people need to know about these vehicles before buying one. These are the things that I wish I knew before I purchased one. And the first thing is that, and it's kind of one of the most glaringly obvious ones, is you don't get a lot with the Workmate model of the 79 series. The reason why I say that is because, you know, the GXL comes with different wheels. They look a little bit more street, you know, they look a little bit less industrial. You know, you do get slightly more features, you get a bit more chrome on things. It's stuff that I'm going to have to cover in a separate video, because guys, the list is just endless. And I have contributed to forums before where people are a little bit, you know, kind of a bit confused about the differences between the Workmate and the GXLs. But yeah, I mean, even things like the interior is different. It's bland, it doesn't have carpet and a bunch of other things in there, which, you know, a lot of people might take a bit of offense to, so, and they don't want in their vehicles. So for me, I got the Workmate for a good reason. It's because I actually like the fact that it's easy to clean. I like the fact there's a bit more of a blank canvas and you get a bit more black on there instead of the chrome. So, and also too, I didn't really have a choice as well, because it was the last ones coming into the country and they weren't GXLs, they were the Workmates. And once I'd done my research, I was like, well, I'm not sure if I want this vehicle or not. Once I did my research, I found out that actually the Workmate was the best model for me anyway. Now, for the second thing that I wish I knew about my 70 series before buying it is in the interior. Again, a bit of a hop, skip and a jump to get in here, because it's pretty high up. And it is the fact that the visibility in here is so good. So if I turn you guys around right now and I'll show you at my eye level, that's what you guys can see going around there. Yes, it's only my carport, but you guys can see that you can see right over the hood from this angle here. And you know, it's so easy to park the vehicle because of the visibility. I thought that I'd have a really hard time trying to park this thing, but actually, yes, the turning circle definitely doesn't help, but you know, the fact that the visibility is really good does help. And you can see right over the top of where these bull bars and ends and stuff like that, so you can really get a good idea of where this vehicle is, especially on the tracks as well, so you can kind of line it up pretty good and not damage any of the bar work or anything like that if you can avoid it. The third thing, and it's kind of the last thing I wanted to talk about, just in regards to the Workmate versus GXL argument, because again, it needs its own video, but it is kind of a big deal, and it's the fact that the Workmate comes with 33-inch tires, and you can kind of see that does take up quite a lot of room in that wheel well there. But you know, if I turn the camera around, you can see that the wheels are the tires are very, very skinny. So, you know, and if you're trying to upgrade to a wider tire, you pretty much need to go with a bigger rim or a wider rim altogether. But and it's kind of an interesting one, because the Workmate has 33-inch wheels and tires, but the GXL only comes with 31. So if you're talking about legality wise running 35s, if you want to do that, then the Workmate's going to be the choice, because absolutely there's not going to be any issues with legalities. Some people have said, oh, because that this little thing exists, which is the tire placard, not sure if that's zooming in or not, but yeah, you got the tire placard there that says GXL, what the tire dimensions are for that, and then you've got what it says for the Workmate. But you know, if your vehicle gets kind of run through the system, model specific, and it shows up that you're actually driving a GXL and you're running 35s and you're trying to convince the person that pulled you up that it's a Workmate, I'm not sure how that will go in the court of law. So that's just something to just consider, that if you want to be super, super safe, the Workmate does come with 33s from the factory, and I have no issues running 35s legally. But I'm sure that there'll be someone out there that would have a little bit more information about it than I would, and that knows a bit more, and I'm sure we'll meet them down in the comment section. So jumping back to the interior, and it is a fact that the, again, a nice little jump in here, and it's the fact that we've got the gear knob is very low down. It's something that not actually a lot of people talk about, but yeah, I do have a gear knob extension on there, and I've got an even bigger one coming because I just find that when I'm sitting back in my seat, I am still leaning just a little bit, so I ordered a slightly bigger extension on that one. So I just found it was just too terrible trying to lean all the way down for the factory one. So that's a super cheap thing. It's like, you know, $15 or something like that, not a big deal, but I would definitely recommend you guys buying an extension on that. I don't recommend you guys buying much for these vehicles just because of you don't need to spend a lot of money on these vehicles to make them usable. They're perfectly fine the way they are from stock, in my opinion. But if you just have 10 or 15 bucks to spare, it makes driving the vehicle 1,000 times better. So number five, we are coming back to the wheels and tires, and it's the fact that these factory wheels, they cop a lot of flack in the forums. And you know, I don't know why. You know, I think that this the wheels and tires suit the vehicle from the factory. It's exactly kind of how it should look if you're talking about a kind of a rugged sort of basic, you know, military-esque vehicle. That's what they're called anyway, isn't it? The military Land Cruiser. So, you know, if we're talking about wheels and tires that suit, in my opinion, these suit. But what kind of annoys me the most is when people say, oh, you need to change the wheels and tires. You don't need to change the wheels and tires. They are perfectly fine. Yes, around the corners, I'll admit they are, you know, the car feels a little bit tippy if you try to go too fast. But if you're going that fast where you feel like the car's going to try to, you know, roll itself over on the roundabout anyway, you're going too fast. So, you know, in my opinion, these things work well off-road. I've done, you know, videos off-road with these tires and wheels, and they are perfectly fine and suited to the vehicle. And these wheels and tires are the reason why I'm getting a little touch over 10 liters per 100 kilometers. As I said in my previous 10 things video. So just so you guys know, don't feel like you need to have $5,000 saved in the bank ready to go to swap out these wheels and tires. But if that's something that you would like to do, then obviously go for it. It's your vehicle anyway. So, but like I said, if it's something that you just were like, oh, I have to change things out, nah, you definitely don't have to do that. Now, I have pretty much at this point, with various things I've done to the vehicle, like, you know, the speaker pod modification and some interior modifications as well, I've pretty much taken apart a good portion of the interior. And let me tell you, believe me when I say that there is no sound deadening in the vehicle at all. It is pretty much like a baked beans tin can. There is absolutely nothing in there to absorb any of the sound. And if you have the Workmate, there's even less because there's no carpet in here. You got the vinyl. So just so you guys are aware, there is, you know, things like rocks hitting the underside, and you know, you hear a lot of creaks, bumps, cracks, whatever, and you definitely know about it when you're going like 100 or 110 on the highway. So just so you guys know that, yes, it is a little bit noisy in there, but more than anything, there's just no sound deadening in this thing at all. That might bother some people, it might not, but for me, it doesn't. But it does affect things like the speaker quality. If you have sound deadening in the doors, it makes it sound a bit better. And obviously, if you're off-roading, this is kind of the point of difference, is if you're off-roading and, you know, you're doing a lot of, you know, there's a lot of loose rocks and stuff around, anything that hits the underside protrudes straight through into the cabin, and you'll hear every rock that hits the car. So coming in at number seven is the fact that there is a lot of room behind these dual cab seats. So if you want to put anything behind here, you can let your imagination run wild. Subwoofers or a little lockbox or anything like that, it's completely up to you. You can even do dual battery setups just behind here as well, if that's what you want to do. It's pretty cool. All you have to do is just basically hit two levers and this thing's going to fold down and then fold forward, and you've got all this room that you can use in this rear section here. And just like that, you've got all this room. So something that I wanted to show you guys, and it's in the interior here, and it is the fact that if you have your door locked, so we shut that, then we lock it down, love the old school lock. If you try to open up your door, it doesn't actually pop the door lock, which is something that I thought was a little bit interesting. So yeah, if you have the door locked and you're trying to use the handle to get out, it actually doesn't pop that lock open. So just in case you're wondering about that one. It's a little bit of a weird one, and it's not really something that a lot of people have talked about, but I kind of feel like that's a little bit strange. I feel like every other vehicle that I've been in should actually open up that lock if you go for the door handle, but who knows, maybe that's just me. So coming in at number 9 is the fact that the factory snorkel is not very well designed at all. So that's why I've got a different one on here. And it didn't cost that much to be able to put a new one on there. I'm a big fan of the plastic design, by the way. And I think that the snorkel actually looks a lot better in that model. Anyway, that's a TJM one. But yeah, I mean, the factory snorkel had so many pieces. I mean, you had that piece on the inside, you had another piece here, and it wasn't properly sealed. And that was kind of something that kind of bothered me a lot. This is another piece that kind of came off it here as well. So that piece was kind of sandwiched on there as a little bit of a, kind of like supposed to be a kind of seal, but that wasn't really how it worked. It left gaps everywhere. And the actual standard snorkel, which I've still got up there for whatever reason, they're not worth anything. It actually had kept a lot of water stored in the bottom of the snorkel. So like when I'd be driving around, it would be sloshing around. So it just goes to show you that whatever it is, whatever design it is, it does not keep any water out at all, which could be a problem, especially if you're doing water crossings. Now coming in at number 10, and stick around because I do have one more after this as well, a little bit of a bonus one for you. But coming in at number 10 is the 79 series Land Cruiser is not built for tall people. The head height is perfectly fine. I have heaps of headroom here, as you guys can see. But when it comes to leg room, there's not really a lot, and there's not a lot of adjustment in the driver's seat as well. I put the driver's seat as far back as I can, and for me that's perfect, but for someone who's any bigger than me, they would be struggling to get in these vehicles, let alone drive them comfortably and for long periods of time. So if you're talking about leg room, this is how much leg room I have. You can kind of see that there. I've got about this much. I'm lucky I don't have long legs at all. I've got most of my height, my torso, which is a bit of a weird fact about me. But you know, it kind of does help when getting in and out of this vehicle as well. But if you're someone who's, you know, kind of around 6 foot or starting to get a little bit taller than that, like maybe 6'2", 6'3", it is kind of difficult to get in and out of this vehicle. So just so you guys know that if you are a bit on the taller side, then yeah, this vehicle can be a bit of a challenge for you. For number 11, I've swapped seats to be in the driver's seat, but I just wanted to show you guys really quick that the sun visor is really, really low. I can't believe this is something that I'm even talking about, but it just kind of bothered me the other day because you know how a lot of cars, they have the sun visors that are set back from the windscreen. So if, say for example, you've got the, and I'm gonna flip you guys around here so you guys can see, but when I say this is about my eye level here. So when I shut the sun visor, or maybe I just put it all the way down, it cuts off, hang on, let me try to get that vision about where it is. It cuts off so much of the road, it's hilarious. And you know how with like other vehicles, you can push the sun visor forward to give you a bit more visibility? Well, this doesn't go as far forward as a lot of the other vehicles to give you that visibility. Again, I'll just readjust to my height here. So there you go, you can kind of see that it doesn't really give you that kind of adjustment, and it cuts off so much of your vision where I end up just not even using it all, because the you know, you sit pretty high up in this vehicle anyway. That's kind of a good feature of this, is the visibility, which I talked about in the last video. But then when you try to use the visor, it just cuts out so much of it. So having like, you know, those fancy two, you know, you get them in some vehicles where you got like a two-part visor, that would be awesome for this vehicle. But again, that's just me being a little bit fussy. Well guys, that concludes today's video of 10 more things, ended up being 11. As I always do, I always like to chuck in an extra one in there. And you know, it's 11 things that I wish I knew about the 70 series before I got it. And these are things that, you know, either I would have been able to prepare myself for, so I'm not maybe a little bit disappointed with some of the features, or maybe they're things that I can fix, or things just not to worry about. That's the big thing at the end of the day, is just, you wanna buy a vehicle, you don't wanna be worrying about all these things that people are telling you online. Well, I guess like me, I suppose, but you know, hopefully this is a bit more of a common sense approach with some of these things anyway, and I hope that that's appreciated by you guys. Now, if you enjoy these kind of informative videos about the 70 series Land Cruiser and you got a bit of value out of it, go ahead, like the video and subscribe. It's free to do so, and I do appreciate it. And comment anything else you would like me to cover for this 70 series Land Cruiser. I mean, you know, I'll probably end up doing the Workmate versus GXL video anyway, because there is a lot of content just in that alone. So I'll probably do that anyway. But if there's something else you want me to cover, guys, please let me know down in the comments section. I love being able to help you out with anything that you want to know or that you're entertained by as well. So I'll leave it there, guys. I do have the tray and canopy, the custom tray and canopy coming for this very, very soon. So make sure that you have clicked that subscribe button and you are following along. And make sure you have a look at my Instagram as well, North Oz Photography, because I do have a few little early updates coming on that as well. So with that said and done, guys, I do appreciate you spending this time with me today, and I'll see you very shortly in the next video. Take care.